Good evening, and welcome to our continuing series on the Life Divine with our brother Ranga. Namaste. We continue Chapter 5, The Destiny of the Individual, beginning with the line, "But as in thought, so in life."
So we'll read the para first.
Yes.
And then come back to it. "But as in thought, so in life, the true rule of self-realization is a progressive comprehension. Brahman expresses itself in many successive forms of consciousness, successive in their relation, even if coexistent in being or coeval in time. And life in its self-unfolding must also rise to ever new provinces of its own being. But if in passing from one domain to another, we renounce what has already been given us from eagerness for our new attainment, if in reaching the mental life we cast away or belittle the physical life which is our basis, or if we reject the mental and physical in our attraction to the spiritual, we do not fulfill God integrally, nor satisfy the conditions of His self-manifestation. We do not become perfect, but only shift the field of our imperfection, or at most attain a limited altitude. However high we may climb, even though it be to the non-being itself, we climb ill if we forget our base. Not to abandon the lower to itself, but to transfigure it in the light of the higher, to which we have attained, is true divinity of nature. Brahman is integral and unifies many states of consciousness at a time. We also, manifesting the nature of Brahman, should become integral and all-embracing." There are one or two things which we need to look at. "But as in thought, so in life." Not only in principle, but even practically, he's saying the true rule of self-realization is a progressive comprehension. You can go only slowly, step by step. No double promotions or triple promotions, as in school. "Brahman expresses itself in many successive forms of consciousness, successive in their relation, even if coexistent in time or coeval in time." So, he's making a distinction. They are, even if they exist all at the same time, still causality demands that you go from one to the other. There's a gradation. First you go to class number one, then you go to class number two, then you go to class number three. You can't jump. So he's saying that, he says this elsewhere also, that you have to go from one level to the other. Jumping from one level to the, skipping some levels can be very dangerous. And it is also, you'll get confused. So you have to go step by step. So he's saying many successive forms of consciousness. He's not specifying them, but as we know, matter, life, mind, then all the intermediate levels, supermind, and then finally Satchidananda. So these are the levels of consciousness that he's speaking about. And he goes into more detail between the mind and the supermind. He has put 7 or 8 layers between them. Higher mind, illumined mind, intuitive mind, overmind, and finally supermind. So these are all gradations which you have to travel step by step, sequentially. You can't do any jumping. Although they all exist together, when you are climbing from one to the other, you have to go just like a ladder. The ladder rungs all exist, but you have to go step by step. In your consciousness, it has to be gradual. And this is as in thought, so in life. That means practically. When you are doing yoga, you have to go step by step. "Brahman expresses itself in many successive forms of consciousness, successive in their relation, even if coexistent in being or coeval in time. And life in its self-unfolding must also rise to ever new provinces of its own being." They are not something else, but they are own being, and yet there are grades. "But if in passing from one domain to another, we renounce what has already been given us from eagerness for our new attainment, which is what the ascetic does, if in reaching the mental life we cast away or belittle the physical life, which is our basis, or if we reject the mental and physical in our attraction to the spiritual, we do not fulfill God integrally, nor satisfy the conditions of His self-manifestation. So first of all, you do not fulfill God integrally, you fulfill God only in one plane of consciousness, if you reject the lower. But He is asking you not to reject the lower, and the new attainment that you have got, make it applicable to all the lower levels also. That's what He is saying. Then, nor do you satisfy the conditions of His self-manifestation. He has taken all the trouble to manifest right up to the inconscient. So, physical, vital and mental also should not be eliminated in your progress when you are going upwards. Go up by all means, but don't lose your footing on the lowest level. Keep yourself firmly grounded here and go up step by step. See that the higher consciousness descends into the lower. This is a very interesting concept in Sri Aurobindo, because in other yogas, there is no clear idea of the descent. In Sri Aurobindo, there is a descent. You, first of all, you have to mount up. You have to, neti neti method, you have to first say to yourself, I am not the body, I am not the life, I am not the mind. And then, denying them, go up into the higher levels of consciousness. Then you will realize the divine only at that level. But the lower remains imperfect. Now he is telling you, by descent, call down the light, the power, the manifest, the love, everything, down into the lower levels of consciousness. If you don't do that, you are realizing God only at the higher levels, ignoring the bottom. And that is not the integral manifestation of God. God has created the lower, but you want to reject it. That's his whole idea. So there is the idea of ascent and descent, which is very, very specific to Sri Aurobindo's idea. By all means, climb up, ascend, but also make it descend. The descent is more difficult than the ascent, because the light has to enter into a dark region, it has to be pulled down. And that was Sri Aurobindo was doing. The maximum thing he could do was to pull down even the supermind into the inconscient here. That was the work he was struggling with after 1926. So, he wants to manifest God integrally, right down to the lower levels of consciousness. So, but if in passing from one domain to another we renounce what has already been given us from our eagerness for our new attainment, if in reaching the mental life we cast away or belittle the physical life, which is our basis, or if we reject mental and physical in our attraction to the spiritual, we do not fulfill God integrally, nor satisfy the conditions of His self-manifestation. Sri Aurobindo has no objection to realizing the divine in the higher levels of consciousness. But his solution is, I am not satisfied only with that. I want it right down to the bottom. That's exactly the whole problem with the Savitri. Savitri is not satisfied by the call into the higher levels of consciousness. She wants all the glory of God, love, consciousness, power, ananda, but all these things for man. It has to come down right to the bottom. That's the whole essence of Savitri.
Even though he offers us all the peace.
Yes. And not only offer, tempting three times.
Three times
the voice goes on.
Yes.
Come up and enjoy. Why do you care for the physical world? It is something unnatural, it is imperfect. You come up and enjoy here. She says, no, I refuse to do that. I want all what you're giving me, give me, but I want it for mankind. It has to come down right to the lower level of consciousness.
For the magnificent soul of man on earth.
Beautiful. Oh. What lines they are. So, we do not become perfect, but only shift the field of our imperfection, or at most attain a limited altitude. If you go up like the ascetic or the normal aim of yoga in India, you go up to the higher levels of consciousness, fine, it's very, very satisfying. But you are ignoring the bottom and you do not fulfill. Sri Aurobindo is using the word, we do not become perfect, but only shift the field of imperfection to a higher level. Your imperfection will become less, no doubt. But it will still remain imperfection if you don't cover all the ranges of consciousness right up to the physical. We do not become perfect, but only shift the field of our imperfection, or at most attain a limited altitude. However high we may climb, even though it be to the non-being itself, we climb ill if we forget our base. Not to abandon the lower to itself, but to transfigure it in the light of the higher to which we have attained, is true divinity of nature. Transformation. The other yogas are saying rejection of the imperfect body-mind life. Sivananda is saying not rejection but transformation. Until now, many yogis have transformed their mind, many yogis have transformed their vital, many yogis have got great results even in the body. Even levitation and all these things are possible. But total divinization of the body has not yet taken place. That will take place in future when the supermind becomes absolutely apparent here in the physical world. So, Brahman is integral and unifies many states of consciousness at a time. We also, manifesting the nature of Brahman, should become integral and all-embracing. Ramakrishna makes a very interesting division between Ishvara Koti and Jiva Koti. Some of these yogis, when they reach a certain level of consciousness, they are stuck to that particular level. They are the Jiva Kotis. But one who can range up and down at will, from the lower to the higher, in other words, all these levels of consciousness are within his range, his power, that is the Ishvara Koti. That's what Sri Aurobindo wants. That you must have power over all the ranges of consciousness, not only one, even if it be higher. So that's the aim for the individual. The destiny of the individual is to realize the divine on all the planes of consciousness, right up to the physical.
Did any other yogis achieve that?
Well, yes, I would think so, because they didn't transform the body, but transformation of mind and vital, I'm sure many have done that. Yeah. In fact, in Sri Aurobindo's case, that sonnet which he says, the golden light came down into my mind and transformed, it came down into my heart, it came down into the lower, it came down right into his feet. So in other words, even his body got changed to a tremendous amount, but it wasn't transformed into a divine body. It was a tremendous body, glowing with a light.
I just want to understand well this Jiva Koti and Ishvara Koti. Can the Jiva Koti become Ishvara Koti at some point?
The possibility is always there, na, for everybody. The possibility is certainly there.
You remember when Purani met Sri Aurobindo after so long, and he saw Sri Aurobindo's body was white?
Yes.
He said, "What has happened to you?" And Sri Aurobindo saw him with a beard and he said, "And what has happened to you?"
That was always Sri Aurobindo's method. He's always put it back. I'll give you two more examples of this counter questioning. Gandhi's son had come here and he asked Sri Aurobindo, "Why are you attached to smoking?" Sri Aurobindo's counter question immediately was, "Why are you attached to non-smoking?" The attachment is the problem. There is another very interesting incident with, this is his nature, he is always counter question and put the same thing, turn it around on the person. When Sri Aurobindo was 3 years old, okay, it's a very interesting incident. And he had an uncle who was Bodo Mama. Bodo Mama in Bengali means elder mama. So he was having, Bodo Mama was having fun with Sri Aurobindo and he showed him a mirror. And he said, "Choto oro, choto bandor." That means, choto bandor means a small monkey. Sri Aurobindo at that age turns the mirror around, faces his uncle and says, "Bodo mama, bodo bandor." Yes. Imagine that humor at that age. So this was, this counter questioning was always there right from the beginning for him. When someone asked Sri Aurobindo, "Why does mother wear silk saris and why does she use lipstick and all that?" Now, Sri Aurobindo's way of answering, fantastic, he said, "Do you want the divine to be represented on earth by ugliness and poverty?"
Or dressed in rags?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
So even the lower must be conquered. We go to the next para?
Yes.
Besides the recoil from the physical life, there is another exaggeration of the ascetic impulse which this ideal of an integral manifestation corrects. The nodus of life is a relation between three general forms of consciousness: the individual, the universal, and the transcendent or supracosmic. In the ordinary distribution of life's activities, the individual regards himself as a separate being included in the universe, and both as dependent upon that which transcends alike the universe and the individual. It is to this transcendence that we give currently the name of God, who thus becomes to our conceptions not so much supracosmic as extracosmic. The belittling and degradation of both individual and the universe is a natural consequence of this division. The cessation of both cosmos and individual by the attainment of the transcendence would be logically its supreme conclusion. So, it's interesting what he's saying. The divine can take the transcendent poise or the universal poise or the individual poise. And normally, the individual is part of the universe, and the universe has been created by God. So there's a tendency to think that that is the highest and the most pure form. The universe is the product of this, and the individual is the product of the universe. So far, so good. No problem. But the divine is, then you, because there's a gradation, there's a tendency to think that there is more divine up, less divine in the universe, and less divine in the universe. So Srimad is saying that idea is corrected by the integral. Divine is equally present in the transcendent, equally present in the universe, equally present in the individual. In fact, this idea, he says in many places, in Life Divine, he mentions that the divine power spends as much energy in creating the constellations and paying as much attention, same amount of attention to the making of an anthill. And in the famous example of the poem Who, the hand that spent Jupiter spinning through heaven spends all its cunning to fashion a curl. So you can't say the divine is more here and less here. It's there everywhere in essence. That's the idea that he's exploring here. So we should not think that the individual has no less value than the universe, and the universe has less value than the transcendent. Not valid. Equally valid. All are equally valid. He says that the individual, in comparison to the universe and the transcendent, seems to be very small, but this is an illusion of quantity. There should be neither an illusion of quantity nor an illusion of quality. The divine is there equally in all. Okay? The integral view of the unity of Brahman avoids these consequences. Just as we need not give up the bodily life to attain to the mental and spiritual, so we can arrive at a point of view where the preservation of the individual activities is no longer inconsistent with our comprehension of the cosmic consciousness or our attainment to the transcendent and supracosmic. For the world transcendent embraces the universe, is one with it, and does not exclude it. Even as the universe embraces the individual, is one with him and does not exclude him. The individual is a center of the whole universal consciousness. The universe is a form and definition which is occupied by the entire immanence of the formless and the indefinable. Okay, so the integral view of the unity of Brahman avoids these consequences. The divine is there equally in all the things. You can't say the divine is more here and less here or anything like that. Equally everywhere, it is there. So it avoids the consequences of that thinking that the transcendent is the highest and the most valid. It's not like that. Just as we need not give up the bodily life to attain to the mental and the spiritual, so we can arrive at a point of view where the preservation of the individual activities is no longer inconsistent with our comprehension of the cosmic consciousness or our attainment to the transcendent and supracosmic. So, usually In India, if you get a spiritual experience, you feel now my whole life, I am an engineer or a doctor, I give up all these things and now devote myself only to the spiritual life. In synthesis, Sri Aurobindo is very clear. You can continue to be an engineer, you can continue to be a doctor and still pursue your spiritual life. You need not reject the lower for the higher. That's what he's stressing here. The same thing. Look at the words. With the preservation of the individual activities, whether it be that of a doctor or an engineer, you don't need to give it up. It is no longer inconsistent with our comprehension of the cosmic consciousness or our attainment to the transcendent and supracosmic. Mm. You can do both at the same time. It may be difficult, but it's possible and preferable to the other. For the world transcendent embraces the universe, is one with it, and does not exclude it. Even as the universe embraces the individual, is one with him and does not exclude him. The individual is a center of the whole universal consciousness. The universe is a form and definition which is occupied by the entire immanence of the formless and the indefinable. The individual is a center of the whole universal consciousness. In every human being, there is a centration of the divine in the individual. The individual is center of the whole universal consciousness. The universe is a form and definition which is occupied by the entire immanence of the formless and indefinable. So, the transcendent is there in the universe everywhere, and the individual also has all these things within himself. He has the transcendent in him, he has also the cosmic consciousness in him. That's why he can expand and become the cosmos.
And he uses the word form.
Yes.
The individual is a form.
Yes. Because everything in the physical world is form. He uses the word form very much for a material form normally. But you can have forms, even subtle forms. Even your emotions have forms, even your thoughts have forms. So forms at the highest level is the only formlessness. That which is transcendent is formless. It makes form and in time and space. Okay? That which is indefinable becomes defined in form. That's what he's saying. This is always a true relation veiled from us by our ignorance or our wrong consciousness of things. When we attain to knowledge or right consciousness, nothing essential in the eternal relation is changed, but only the in-view and the out-view from the individual center is profoundly modified, and consequently also the spirit and effect of its activity. The individual is still necessary to the action of the transcendent in the universe, and that action in him does not cease to be possible by his illumination. On the contrary, since the conscious manifestation of the transcendent in the individual is a means by which the collective, the universal, is also to become conscious of itself, the continuation of the illumined individual in the action of the world is an imperative need of the world play. If his inexorable removal through the very act of illumination is the law, then the world is condemned to remain eternally the scene of unredeemed darkness, death and suffering. And such a world can only be a ruthless ordeal or a mechanical illusion. This is an interesting way of putting it, what he is saying. It can be looked at in many ways. This is always the true relation veiled from us by our ignorance or our wrong consciousness. The ignorance is nothing but a wrong consciousness or our wrong consciousness of things. When we attain to knowledge or right consciousness, nothing essential in the eternal relation is changed. The individual remains the same, the cosmos remains the same, the transcendent remains the same. Only the individual has graduated in his consciousness from one level to another level. He is using different instruments of perception and experience. At the lower level, senses. So the world is real to him, that which is above is not real to him. He goes to the subtle world, uses subtle instruments of knowledge, his view changes. But nothing has changed externally to him. The individual remains the same, the cosmos remains the same, the transcendent remains the same. Only he is climbing up and looking at it from different angles and different instruments of knowledge. So his way of looking at things changes, nothing changes in the objective world, if you want to put it that way. Nothing changes there. When we attain to knowledge or right consciousness, nothing essential in the eternal relation is changed, but only the in-view and the out-view. Psychologically also, when you look at yourself, you have gone to another level of consciousness, you see yourself in a different way, in-view and also the view of the cosmos, the out-view. Both change. Right now, I can hardly look into myself, but if I go to a higher level of consciousness, I will see things in myself which I never saw before. My in-view will change. The out-view also will change. I'll start seeing in a totally different way. And from the individual center is profoundly modified, and consequently also the spirit and effect of its activity. Naturally, if I see things in a different way, my behavior also will change. That is very obvious. The individual is still necessary to the action of the transcendent in the universe, and that action in him does not cease to be possible by his illumination. But the divine is acting, his will is manifesting itself in the divine, in the universe. How? It is manifesting, his will is manifesting, but it is coming through different layers of darkness. It is coming through and it is getting expressed through each individual. So your actions, which you think are your actions, are actually his actions, but your density and your form is modifying that action, and you think that that action is yours. Actually, it is not. It's a divine action, but limited and modified by your limitations and your form. So I like to put it in this way. Think of yourself as a vessel. Each individual is a vessel of a different shape and of a different color. And the divine action, if you think of it as water pouring down here and occupying each vessel, it is taking the form of that particular vessel and the color of that form. So the divine intention is what you are doing, but in a distorted and degraded manner. It's a divine intention which is taking place through each individual, but it is conditioned by the form and limitation of the individual.
But intention, it is in the largest sense, isn't it?
Yes.
In the largest sense. Or exactly like we are planning the day, is it behind the divine is planning the day, or we are, is our mental activity doing some distortion?
Your mental activity is a
distortion.
Distorting the thing coming down.
So the energy is his.
Yes.
But some distortion is ours.
Yes. The distortion and the, our contribution is the distortion and the changing of the, that which is coming down. Because we are dark, there are layers of darkness, and that light which is coming down is getting conditioned by the darkness. So the divine intention is there, but still the individual is very necessary. Ultimately, it's through the individual that things get done. He is not saying that here, but in another place also he says that all the greatest discoveries are always by the individual. No scientific discovery, no medical discovery, no philosophical discovery, no spiritual discovery is ever done by the collectivity. It is always the individual who does it. So the individual is so important for Srivamdo. He must be given full credit for that. And once the individual has done that work, it becomes the common property of all mankind. You can see that in everything. Every discovery is the individual who does it. And that's why Srivamdo pays so much importance to the freedom of the individual. He is not at all in favor of a collective society or these collectivities. He is not interested. The collectivity is important, no doubt. But the individual is the one that must make the first breakthrough, and then it becomes part of the collectivity. So Srivamdo is saying, if the individual is dark, the divine intention is working through him in a dark way. But if he gets illumined, that divine intention is still continuing to come down, and now it will come down without distortion. That's what he's saying. So look at the sentence. The individual is still necessary to the action of the transcendent in the universe, and that action in him does not seem to be possible, does not cease to be possible by his illumination. In fact, now he will express the divine intention much better, because there is no obstruction. He has become illuminated, and there are no obstructions and no bars. It comes down fully, and he, in fact, his will becomes completely the divine will. He has no more a will of his own. So So if that man after illumination, like the ascetic, says, I don't want to remain in the physical world, I want to go up, the divine action is to continue only through limited individuals and not an illuminated individual. So Srivamdev is saying, after illumination, remain in the world and become an instrument of God. Then you can, the divine can act much more powerfully in the world.
He also said that he didn't think saints would be interested in his yoga.
Because they are interested only in the higher one, the saint, mostly. Okay, so the importance he gives to the individual is very great. On the contrary, since the conscious manifestation of the transcendent in the individual is the means by which the collective, the universal, is also to become conscious of itself, the continuation of the illumined individual in the action of the world is an imperative need of the world play. The illuminated individual must continue to be here to do God's work. Imperative. If his inexorable removal through the very act of illumination is a law, then the world is condemned to remain eternally the scene of unredeemed darkness, death and suffering. How will the divine work in the world without the instrumentation of illuminated individuals? If all the individuals illuminates go up, he doesn't have instruments to work here. The one question may come up in our minds that he is all powerful, why does he need instruments here? But these are all self-made laws. He has himself created the manifestation and there is darkness here. You must remember that this is his self-made laws and he obeys his own laws. He does not act miraculously. He always acts according to the laws he has made. So that's why naturally he has to act in the darkness here. And that's the reason why the evolution is so slow. But as it becomes more and more progressive, the rate of evolution increases. It goes faster and faster.
Ranga, Mother speaks so much about the collective consciousness and she's created Auroville.
Yes, because it must finally percolate right down to the lowest level. That's right. It's not that the collectivity is not important, but the individual is more important.
Yes.
One question I want to ask regarding the difference between the words supracosmic and extracosmic.
That's a very interesting question. I was going to deal with that. Tell me, what do you think it is?
See, I checked the meaning. Extra means out.
Yes.
And supra means above.
Yes.
But if you think it out and above basically means the same thing. So the distinction is not quite clear.
It depends on how you are visualizing it.
I mean, out is horizontal, above is vertical.
Now I'll tell you. So, when the individual goes into the transcendent consciousness, when he goes into the nirvana, he feels the universe to be outside himself. You are in a transcendent consciousness and you feel that you are outside the universe. That's the extra cosmic. But if you think that no, this is also, you have to see the links. If you see the links between the higher and the lower, then you don't think it to be extra cosmic but supra cosmic at the highest level. That's the difference. Extra cosmic means outside the universe. You have no connection with it. And that often happens. It's not, if you remember when we read that other chapter, when you make your mind silent, you have three choices. You are in a cosmic consciousness and you don't reject the physical world, you embrace it. Or if you are in the nirvana consciousness, you see the physical world as unreal, as an illusion, and you reject it. At that time, you are outside the universe and you don't want to have anything to do with the imperfections of the universe, you reject it. But in Srivamdev's case, although he saw the physical world as unreal, he said, I will wait, I won't jump to conclusions. I will tolerate this experience and wait further. So three possibilities when you make your mind silent. You reject the world if you are in a nirvanic consciousness and transcendent consciousness, extra cosmic, if you are in a consciousness, even where you see the physical world as part of yourself, you are in a cosmic consciousness, you don't reject the physical world. Srivamdev used the word embrace. You embrace the physical world. Or even as Srivamdev had the experience of the nirvana, he didn't reject the physical world. He says, I can't think that the ultimate reality is dual. I can't think that it can be two. It has to be one. There has to be perfect harmony between the lower and the higher. So he waited until that emptiness started filling up with all the power, consciousness, love and all these things started pouring into him. Then he could make a connection between the two. He lays a lot of stress between the links. He says if the links are not there, and that's why he has spent a lot of energy, so many chapters on the links. First 10 chapters, I told you the other day, creating the links between supermind and the physical world. Then each one he examines and sees that there is a connection. Sat becomes matter, Chit Shakti becomes the vital, Ananda becomes the psychic being, supermind becomes the mind. But all these which it becomes in the physical universe in a degraded, diminished manner. But they are all, their parents are all there at the higher level of consciousness. So the links has to be seen. If you see the links, you are in a supra-cosmic consciousness. If you don't see the links, you feel yourself to be extra-cosmic. The experience may be the same as you are pointing out. But it's a way of how you perceive. You can perceive it in different ways.
So, when you said that Sri Aurobindo said, I want to wait, so he waited till he could have the simultaneous experience of the transcendent cosmic as well as individual.
Yes, that which seemed empty to him, when you make your mind silent and go to the Nirvana consciousness, it's an emptiness. The self, the experience of the self is a featureless emptiness. That emptiness is actually not empty, it is full of the possibilities of everything, but you can see it as an emptiness also. If you see it as an emptiness, you are a Buddhist. So he saw it as an emptiness, but he says somewhere he is getting a feeling that this can't be the ultimate experience. So he waits. So after a period of time, maybe it was 6 months or so, this emptiness started filling up. Power, love, knowledge more and more started pouring into him. So he knew that there is another level of consciousness which harmonizes these two seemingly opposite conditions. Spirit and matter seem to be opposite conditions, but there is a third level which harmonizes them. That's why his whole stress on the supermind, which is the third level. We stop here for today.